So maybe you guessed by now, but today we're going to talk about HTML, which stands for Hypertext Markup Language. HTML is used to structure a web page and all of its content, and so all web pages are made up of HTML. What you're looking at now is a web page that I made. We can view the source to see the HTML code of this web page. All HTML documents have the same general structure. First, there's a head section, followed by a body section, and those two are nested inside of an HTML. So you could say the way HTML elements are nested are kind of like boxes. One goes inside the other. So let's look at all the parts of this web page. First, there's this doctype HTML, and that basically says, hey, this is an HTML5 document. And that just goes at the top. And this whole web page is enclosed in an HTML element. And like we said before, the HTML element contains the head element and the body element. So you know you're looking at HTML when you see elements, which are used to enclose, wrap, or differentiate parts of content to make them appear or act a certain way. For example, you can create a paragraph by writing some text in a P. Most elements are made up of two parts, the opening tag and the closing tag. The opening tag begins the HTML element, while the closing tag closes the HTML element. The closing tag has a slash in it. It's important to note that not all elements have opening and closing tags. These are called empty elements, and there's a full list of them on Mozilla's website. Mozilla also has a reference page for every HTML element that exists, so you can scroll down this page and see what each one does. And that said, you can't make up your own HTML elements. Also, as a general guide, I really recommend Mozilla's documentation because it's very thorough. So if you're looking for something, I just encourage you to Google MDN, which stands for Mozilla Developer Network, and then plus whatever you're curious about. So HTML, CSS, JavaScript, and you should get to some pretty great content. Elements can also have attributes. Attributes contain extra information about the element, which doesn't appear in the visible content. So in this example, we're giving the paragraph a class of special. And it might not make much sense now, but with this identifying name, we can target this element for style, maybe later when we learn CSS. Another example of an attribute, but on a different element, might be here. This is a link, an A element. The href equals in the link tells you where the link goes if you click it. Back to our HTML element box. Try guessing what's in this box by looking at the code. The head element always goes before the body element, which is why it's on top in this box. Let's talk about the head section first. All of the invisible or metadata type stuff goes inside the head section. The title element contains some text. In our case, it contains Literature Works because that's the title of our site. This is the text that shows up at the top of your browser tab, or when you bookmark the site, or when the site appears in Google search results. It looks like some of the contents of our box shifted in a new order during transit. But anyway, this is the meta element with the attribute charset equals UTF-8. This element specifies the document's character encoding, or the character set the document can use. UTF-8 is a universal character set, meaning you can use almost any character from any human language. So by default, it's a good idea to put this on your pages. Here's another meta element, this time with two attributes. So this line isn't required, but it's good now that we're in the age of mobile devices. So whenever a mobile device views this HTML page, this line of code in the head makes sure the device doesn't automatically resize the page, but lets it appear the size it automatically is. So having this line will eventually give you more control over how the web page looks on mobile devices. So here's a link element. This is the line of code that helps you have a fav icon. A fav icon is a small picture that appears next to the title of your site. So here, we're telling the link element to look for an image we called pebble.png, which we saved in the same directory as this index.html page. So now let's look at the body element. This is where all the visible stuff goes, or the things that actually appear on your web page. So the body is unlike the head, and if you remember before, the head contains all the invisible information or the metadata. So you can put things inside your body that will show up, like paragraphs or images or headings. Those all go inside the body. So first we have an image element, followed by an H1, followed by a P, followed by another P, and then followed by a third P. So let's look at these in order. The first is the image, and it has an attribute of src equals pebble.png. And that basically says, hey, display an image here and find pebble.png. Next, we have an H1 element. H1 is the biggest heading you can possibly have, which is basically the title. And inside of it is the pebble. There are other heading elements. It goes H1, H2, H3, H4, H5, H6, H6 being the smallest, H1 being the biggest. Our first paragraph says inside an excerpt. The second paragraph has a lot more text. So here it is. And the third paragraph has two things, actually. It has some text, the source of the excerpt. And then it has an A element, which is a link. And it looks like it has a little pink paper, which means it has an attribute. The attribute says href equals quote, and then a link where the poem was sourced from. And then inside of the A says source, and this is the text that turns by default blue and underlined, meaning that you can click it and then go to that link that we mentioned in the attribute. So to review, the body contains all the visible things, and the head contains all the invisible things, or the metadata. In both of these, the head and the body are inside of the HTML. Now let's make our own HTML page from scratch. Let's first find an HTML skeleton. This might not look like much, but if we view the source, this will have everything we need. It's very similar to what we had before. So let's copy it, and then open up our text editor and paste it. I like to create a new folder for each of my sites in my sites folder. So I'll do that, and then I'll save this as index.html inside. You'll notice that when you save something as .html, the colors change. This is called syntax highlighting, and it's different for each language. It's really helpful. So you can start inserting your own content. You'll want to replace the default title with your own title. And then I have some pictures ready I want to put on the page, so I'll put them in the site folder. And then I'll use the img element to place them on the page. I can drag that .html file into a web browser to preview it. You can look at any website's source code or HTML by going to View, Developer, View Source in Google Chrome. You could also use the shortcut. Another important way to view code is by going to View, Developer, Developer Tools. This is called Web Inspector, and it's a little window, and you can size it however you want and put it on the bottom, or even you could pop it out into a different window. But I like it on the side. Using this arrow key in the upper left, you can mouse over different things you see on the page and see what HTML element it corresponds to. It's important to note that most websites you see have style on top of their HTML skeleton. So, as an experiment, we can use this bookmarklet called Kill Styles to see what web pages look like with only their HTML. This is all to say that having styles for a web page is totally natural, but you should still care about your HTML, and you should use the most specific element you can depending on the content. Sometimes you'll hear this phrase, semantic HTML, and semantic just means meaning, and of course meaning helps in communication. So using the right element adds another layer of meaning to your web page. It's also important to use the correct elements just in case someone is on a bad connection and your style sheet doesn't load. So the website should still communicate and it should still function. Knowing why errors occur in HTML will help us write better HTML. So what's wrong with this HTML? The head element wasn't closed. That's like a two-sided box. Which example is badly nested? What's missing on this attribute? Sometimes you'll find while using your text editor that syntax highlighting or the colors of the words will help you find these errors. W3C has an HTML validator. And here it's telling us that we didn't close our title element. Like I said before, empty elements are edge cases that don't have an opening and a closing tag. And yes, both of these work. I don't really have the answers to these questions, but Blue has a rich history in computing. These both result in an identical-looking web page, so a computer reads these exactly the same. So indentation is mostly helpful for humans so that we can tell what elements are inside what elements and for general organization purposes.